That was just a little taste. You're going to get a little taste of what Marcus and Laura Pridgen do every day. And so they're going to share what goes on in Jerusalem, what they do in and out of Jerusalem. So they're going to share that this morning. And you are going to be so glad I let them share, because you have to listen to me less. So it's all good. So I would like you to welcome our friends, Marcus and Laura Pridgen.
Thank you.
So there is a really, when we talk about discipleship, and we like to call that apprenticing, it's the same word. We don't use the word discipleship in our culture. But when we think of apprenticing someone, that is a perfect example of what Jesus did for his disciples. You know, Jesus would take them and say, wax on. No, he didn't do that. But he would teach them, he would show them. And so I want to start with a question today that then will lead into the rest of the message. And that question is this: what if you were the last Christian on earth? Would there be any more Christians after you? Have you ever taught anyone what you know, anything about the Christian life? And, of course, as a church, we partner together to help people find their way home to Christ. But are you teaching what you know? So let me ask you a question today, and I think it's interesting. You know, in our culture, do you feel like we've lost the sense of community as a culture? We have Facebook, but we've lost connectedness, even with all the connections. And let me tell you where Christians struggle sometimes, okay? And I've struggled with this, so I'm going to help you a little bit, I hope. This is, I know it's not really Tupperware, it's rubber. Oh, it is Tupperware. Just realized, somebody said, that's Rubbermaid, but it says Tupperware here and here, brand new. Anyway, so Tupperware. How many of you have some piece of Tupperware or Rubbermaid in your house? How many of you have more lids than you have things? Okay, all right. So, you know, what's this lid for? I don't know. Okay, so everybody has Tupperware, and Robin Williams used to go, but anyway, so if we're not careful, we think of our lives as Tupperware. Here's what I mean by that. You think, okay, here's my spiritual bucket or my spiritual Tupperware, and if my Bible study, my prayer, I came to church today. By the way, you guys are winning. You came to church today. Nice job. Give yourself a hand. You showed up. That's good. Because, listen, on the days when you really need it, everything inside of you will say, stay home. On the days where you really need to come to church, those are the days you're going to fight it the most, and that's the day you show up and you go, right? So, spiritual Tupperware. So we think spiritual things are in this bucket. Reading our Bible, teaching somebody else to read the Bible, helping somebody to find their way home to Christ. We see all that, right? And then over here we have our other Tupperware. And that's our jobs, which we don't think of as spiritual. That might be that you know how to bake cookies. It might be that you're good at knitting. It might be that you're a bookkeeper. It might be that you know how to balance a checkbook. It could be that you know how to make good coffee. Or maybe, you know, you're just good at encouraging people. Maybe you're good with children. We put all that over here in this bucket, and we think somehow that this is our spiritual life, and this is our normal life, whatever that is. The truth is, the Bible says that when you become a Christian, you become a brand new creation, a brand new person. It doesn't say part of you. And Jesus never separated the spiritual part from the, what we would call, secular part. He said, do all things. Paul said, do all things like you're doing to them to the Lord. So let me just throw this out real quick. If you know how to bake cookies, you can bake cookies and encourage somebody to know Christ. If you know how to make soup, you can make soup and help a sick person to find their way home to Christ. Or bring cookies, for example, to the homeless folks. They do a feeding up in Titusville, 7-6 on Mondays under the bridge. Or you know how to knit caps. We've got some ladies who know how to knit caps, and they came to me one time and said, hey, we know how to knit. What can we do? I said, the port ministry needs people to knit stuff. And so they found out there's Russian sailors. And these Russian sailors, apparently a lot of them are bald, and they need caps. I think they need to do a pink one, just because you know one of the guys is going to be like, I like that, and harass. He's probably the biggest guy, and if anybody messes with his big hat, he just grabs him and throws him off the ship. It's awesome. I can see it, right? And so Russian sailors are not only getting knit caps, they're getting the Jesus videos and learning about who Jesus is. See, we tend to separate things. But last week we had Christian workers from Jerusalem that came, and she's a bookkeeper, and he's a truck driver. And God uses truck drivers. And too often, we separate those things, and we have this idea that this is my Christian life. I went to church, and I did this, and this is my secular life. I do this. Listen, quit doing that. It's not biblical. And so, as I was thinking about this today, I want you to first think of this. If your neighbors, if your children, if your grandchildren, if your nieces and nephews, the people you work with, if on the day you died, they said the theme of their life is, how would they fill in that blank? Now, let me be honest with you. For me, too often, and for so much of America, too often, our theme when people interrupt our schedules, our theme when people don't let us finish what we're trying to finish, our theme is, you're in my way. You're bothering me. You're making my life difficult. You're keeping me from what's really important. And if that's the theme of our life, we have missed it. If you read the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, over and over, Jesus was on his way somewhere. He's headed somewhere. And he gets interrupted. People come out and go, hey, I can't see. Hey, we're lepers. Hey, I've been bleeding all my life. People interrupted him. And Jesus didn't look and say, quit interrupting me. You know what he did? He realized that that interruption was exactly what God did, and he realized that the people were more important than his journey. Now, I will let you know, your pastor does not realize that when he's driving a car. I don't even have to be in a hurry to get aggravated with people. Somebody ran a stop sign this morning to pull out in front of me in a hurry and then went 20 miles an hour, to which I gave them a full sermon. You know, if you were in a hurry, you would keep driving over the speed limit, not under it. But you ran the stop sign and then decided you were no longer in a hurry, right? And so I'm doing this, but if we're not careful, we will do that with people that we love. We'll be like that BBC guy, I don't know if you saw the video, he's doing a newscast and his kids come in, and if you watch him, he actually stiff arms his daughter. Now, I understand, I get it, this is the guy's job. Somebody said he's probably wearing a bathing suit, the reason he didn't stand up, right? They remade one with a mom, and the mom puts the kid on her lap and keeps talking and makes dinner and, you know, all that stuff. But truth be known, if we're not careful, that's what we do to anybody who interrupts us. People tell me all the time when I say, would you rather work with people or work by yourself? All the time, by myself. Leave me alone. Let me get my work done. What's your priority in life? See, when we start to realize that God has called us to be disciple makers, it's one of the few commands that Jesus gave us, that we realize people aren't in the way, people are the way. People aren't in the way, they matter to you. So I want your theme to be, you matter to me. And to go out of your way and pass on the things that you know to other people so that you can use that gift to help somebody to find their way home to Christ. And if they're believers, so that then they can take that gift that you teach them, whether it's baking cookies, working on a car, knitting caps, how to have a Bible study, and they can pour that out on someone else and not separate just your spiritual things from your non-spiritual things. My boys are mowing my grass now. And we have a lawnmower that's a little finicky. Okay, it doesn't want to shut off. Kind of a problem, just a slight problem. So I had to teach my boys first how to shut this thing off, this evil lawnmower. It's supposed to be an automatic cutoff. If you're an OSHA member, please don't come to my house. And so I'm teaching them to mow. So what do? Ricky's not really mowed our yard. So I tell him, hey, first you got to pick up everything, and then this is how you do it, and right, and then I let him do it. I'm teaching them, discipling them in mowing grass. Did you know you can mow grass for Jesus? Not only at your house, but to be a blessing to somebody else who needs it. A neighbor, a friend, somebody who's hurting, somebody who's gone out of their way. You can do that for Jesus. And too often we separate our spiritual from non-spiritual instead of saying, God, how can I use this to be a blessing, to disciple, to reach out, to pour my life into someone else. So I want to give you four reasons why we don't apprentice anyone. And I changed the whole sermon yesterday because this list, my plan was just to read you this list. Let's see. I was just going to say, we don't think we're experts. We have a biblical view of Christianity. We don't want to sacrifice our comfort. We don't want to know anyone wants to learn. And then go on to the sermon. But as I began to pray and think about this message, I realized this. You really do want your life to make a difference. You really do want the things that you know how to do. You'd love to be able to do that. So that's not what's holding you back. So I want to first talk about, we don't think we're experts. And I want to camp here for just a minute because I feel like that this is so true with Christians in church. And it's the enemy's attack that does this. This is where Satan comes in and says, I know how to stop you and I can do it very easily. In Luke chapter 10, verse 27 and 28, Jesus gave the two commands. And we boil it down by saying love God and love people. But it doesn't just say love people. It says love your neighbor as you love yourself. Okay, let's say it again. Ready? Love your neighbor as you love
yourself.
Love your neighbor as you love yourself, right? So here's the deal. And I love it when psychologists are figuring out what Jesus said 2,000 years ago was right. Here's what they figured out. If you can't love you, you can't love other people. Oh, well, I can. Yes, I can. No. You can do things for them. You can perform for them. You can do things that seem like you love them. But if you really are going to love them, you have to love you, which means you have to receive God's love. And here's what the enemy wants to do with number one. We don't think we're experts. He wants to shame you. So even in the sermon, last sermon, and anybody who was here, I said a couple of things that as soon as they came out of my mouth, I said, oh, how embarrassing. Can't believe I just said that. And you know why I do that? Because you do the same thing. As you go through life, the enemy wants you to think you have no value. How can you teach somebody else? Look at you. Most of the Bible is written by murderers. I mean, Moses wrote the first five, the most important books of the Old Testament. He killed a man. Paul killed people. He at least stood there and helped them to be killed. He was in on it, persecuting Christians, killing Christians. And yet, those are the people God uses. And so often, though, we allow our shame to get us. And the other thing we do is we allow our blame to get us. And so we either feel ashamed, I can't do it, or we begin helping, we begin doing something, and as soon as we start to do it, you know what happens? Somebody doesn't do something right, and we go, I'm not helping anymore because of God, look at this woman you gave me. Just like Adam, remember? Adam said, hey, the woman gave it to me. You know, the woman you gave me. So he blames God. That's a good start, by the way. What's wild is nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. As soon as you, listen, if you overcome shame and you say, I'm going to serve, the next attack Satan has is blame. And he'll tell you, oh, you see, look at that. You shouldn't do that anymore. We've had people quit because somebody asked them to close a door. Can you close the door? I can't believe you asked me to close the door. I mean, what? And of course, listen, my reasons for quitting things are perfect and yours are terrible, right? My problems are huge, yours, small, right? That's how we look at life. Our miracles are big and the other people's are small. Our problems are huge and theirs are little. Here's the deal. Satan, if he can't get you to put shame on you or he can keep you from doing anything, he'll begin to get you to blame. So that when you start doing it, you'll go, that person, I can't do it anymore. Instead of looking at God. This is where the enemy gets the most involved. This is why all through the Bible it talks about spiritual warfare and praying and asking God to take down strongholds. Why? Because we grew up a certain way. We learned bad habits. And guess what? We've taken it naturally. We don't need any help. And so we shame and we blame. And so if you're going to learn to disciple people, you've got to push through the shame. Realizing we're all broken. I love when people come to me at church and they'll come up and they've never gone to church. They show up for a few weeks and they come up and they go, Pastor Eric, I want to tell you, I love your sermons because you make me feel normal. And I know what they mean. They mean you're an idiot and you make me feel so much better that you can be an idiot. So it's okay. God can use an idiot. And I'm like, that's exactly right. God uses donkeys every week right here. He uses imperfect, broken, messed up people. And the reason you're here today, the reason I'm here today is because there were disciples who overcame the shame through the cross and the blood of Jesus Christ, and they overcame the blame of trying to blame others, and they just did what God called them to do. So the other thing we do, we have an unbiblical view of Christianity. We think Christianity is about sitting in rows and having somebody speak, and we go home and feel good about ourselves. That's not biblical Christianity. It's taking what you've learned and pouring it out on someone else. Taking what you've learned and pouring it out on somebody else. Disciple, make disciples. It didn't say make people who sit in rows. Number three, we don't want to sacrifice our comfort. This goes with the hiding part. We don't like to be bothered. And when you work with other people, guess what? It's not easy. They're people. They're as broken as you are, but in different ways that aggravate you, right? And then number four, we don't know anyone who wants to learn. That's a lot of times our excuse. Well, I don't know anybody who needs, because we tend to think it's only the spiritual things. Trust me, if you know how to do anything, there is somebody who needs how to learn how to do that. And if you know how to make cookies, I can point you to lots of people who need your gift, and some who don't. All right. So why should we apprentice others? We're going to look at the example of Jesus, Moses, and Paul. Jesus, Moses, and Paul. Number one, Jesus told us to follow his example. Therefore, Jesus said, go and make disciples. This word in the Greek and then also in the Hebrew is the idea of following in the dust of the master. It meant to follow Jesus around and watch what he did. When he said, wax on, wax off, we said, wax on, wax off. And then you notice the disciples would go out and try something, and they'd go, that didn't work. And they'd say, well, that's because you did it without prayer and fasting. You know, like, oh, we have to pray? Well, didn't know that, right? And so Jesus taught his disciples. It says, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey some of what I commanded. No, he didn't say that. He said, teaching them to obey everything I commanded you. And surely, don't call me Shirley, I am with you always to the very end of the age. So if your name's Shirley, he's with you twice. But he's with us. Now, I have some bad habits that I've learned from other people. You do too. Okay? Some of you learned how to smoke. Somebody taught you how to smoke. What great discipleship that is, right? Some of you learned how to drink, and you learned how to drink at a party. Great discipleship. I mean, if you want to know what discipleship is, it's how we learn those bad habits. And if you think of it that way, then you'll be like, oh, I should teach the good ones the same way. Let me give you one of my bad habits, because I did it yesterday. I went to Aldi yesterday, picked up a little ham. Oh, I got little hams. There's just a few bucks. They had two meals. It's awesome. They're pre-cooked. And so mine's in the crock pot now with some potatoes all wrapped up. When I get home, I just go here. And we eat. It's great. So I'm leaving Aldi, and I have to turn left at the light onto Highway 50. And I pull in there, and there's like 10 cars in front of me. And the light turns green. There's only two colors, dude. Well, there's three, but the middle one doesn't count. Go. Come on. Come on. Okay. That's one. All right. Second guy's going. Oh, man. Look at the space. Look at the space between. Come on. Right? Right? If I could, I would push them all out into the intersection, right? Now, where did I get that? Can I tell you something? My dad, when I was a kid, in Miami, I remember sitting at these lights. And in Miami, if you missed a light, you're talking maybe 10 minutes. Some of the lights are 10 minutes. So dad's there going, one car, two cars. Oh, come on, go, three cars. Every time, every light, every time. And guess what? His son was discipled by him in how to drive. Now, the good news, it gets less and less, because my grandfather, my aunt told me this story. Now, my grandfather was born in the 1800s. I know it's a long story, but he was born in like 1898. And so my grandfather, though, before there were air-conditioned cars, the light only had two lights, and the light would turn green, and my grandfather instantly would lay on the horn and yell, let's go! So I'm a third generation failure at driving. I have a feeling my great grandfather was, come on, get the buggy, let's go, we got things to do, you can't hop in. You know, I don't know. You've been discipled, and some of how you've been discipled is wrong. Some of the shame you carry around is because somebody taught you that. We get it natural, it's easy. Boy, isn't it amazing how quick we pick up bad habits? So let's think of it. God, how can I follow the example of Jesus and teach other people what I know? Some things, like I said, you might think they're not spiritual, but the truth is you're a new creation. Everything you do can be done for Jesus Christ. Number two, we burn out alone and we burn bright together. Moses is recapping his time with the Israelites, and here's what he says. He says, how can I bear your problems and your burdens and your disputes all by myself. All by myself. Choose some wise and understanding and respected men from each of your tribes, and I'll set them over you. What was he showing? Original discipleship, passing it on to other people. Now, you see me up here all week, but you don't realize there's been tens of people that are here. I know tens. I wanted to say hundreds, but it just didn't make any sense. But there are tens of people that are here starting at about 7 or even sometimes a little before every Sunday morning to set up the chairs. There's people who help during the week to make sure you get a bulletin and it's stuffed and all the stuff's in it. It takes a whole army of people. Now, can I tell you, I know how to set up chairs, but I don't set up chairs. I know how to do a lot of things, but I don't do them all. Why? Because I would be burned out. And actually, I used to help set up chairs, and one of our folks came to me that helped set up, and they said, please don't help set up anymore. You sweat and you stink, so stop. You can help after. That is a true story that I wish was not. So Moses even reminds him, hey, I needed help. It's okay to need help, and we need to not be so prideful we think we can do everything. And the truth is, in that needing help, we also need to build relationships. How many times, Dad, when your kids came and asked you a question when you were in the middle of something, you said, leave me alone, I'm busy, instead of saying, hey, come, you can help me with this. And by the way, if you say, come and help me with this, as soon as they become teenagers, they won't come and help you. You just, hey, come help me with this. They'll never bother you again during your project. You'll be like, I got all this time alone. I don't know. John Maxwell said that if you can teach somebody to do something 80% as effectively as you, give it to them. Give it to them. Number three, we multiply our influence. Everybody wants to have influence after they die. Everybody. Paul in 2 Timothy, the verse we're about to read, knows that he's near death. The book of 2 Timothy is Paul's last book. Remember, Paul was a persecutor of Christians. He was named Saul. God changed his name. Paul wrote most of the New Testament, or much of the New Testament. And yet here he is coming to the end of his life. Nero has taken over. He's already hearing about Christians killed. They were taking Christians to light Nero's garden and putting them in Nero's garden on posts alive and lighting them on fire. Yeah. They were crucifying Christians. Most people think one of his friends was named Seneca, who was a philosopher at the time, who was close to Nero, and Nero had Seneca killed himself. So Paul, knowing all this, has poured his life into Timothy. And by the way, you should have somebody who you're pouring your life into that's your Timothy, but you should also have somebody who's your Paul that's pouring their life into you. You should also have a Barnabas, somebody that comes along beside you and encourages you, but you look for, hey, who's pouring into my life? Whose life am I pouring into? And who's on this journey with me? You then, my son, Paul says, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. You're going to hear this verse again in a minute. And the things you heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. People that when you teach, they'll teach. When you show them, they'll do it. When you do what I did, they'll do what I did. The reason you're here today is because somebody taught the disciples. Jesus could have had angels preach. It'd be much better. They'd show up and you'd be in awe. They'd be huge. And they'd get up and they would say everything exactly what God wanted them to say. Be no human, no humanity. Wouldn't make mistakes. Say dumb things from the stage every week. But that's not God's choice. He wanted us to disciple each other so that we realize God can use even you. Even you. So you know why I'm a pastor? It's because growing up I had a pastor who took over our church that I realized, hey, I like that. And then I went and interned at a church called Park Avenue when Peter Lord was there. And Peter Lord would start out and tell stories. He'd tell 15-minute stories to start the service. I thought, I can tell stories. I knew that. And then I went in college and I worked for a guy named George Thomason. George Thomason taught me how to bass fish. And I watched it, and I realized just a few weeks ago, I was looking at my schedule. My schedule is very similar to George. George took every Monday off. I take Mondays off, kind of, mostly. And he would take a half-day Friday. I take half-day Friday. Now, he didn't have Saturday night church. It's unfair, but anyway. But I looked, and I said, you know what? I learned how to do my schedule based on what George did with his schedule. And then I met a guy named Harold Brantley when I first started in ministry. And Harold came and spoke at our church. And I went up to Harold. This was the first thing I ever said to Harold. I said, Harold, I really like you. This is after a sermon he did where he talked about some people that I knew. He didn't know that he was talking to me. That's the people I knew. And he talked about some excesses that they were into. And he didn't like them. And he was saying, why? That's a danger. And I went to him. I said, Harold, I want you to know I like you, but I didn't like your sermon. What a great introduction from a 20-something-year-old punk, right? You know what Harold said? Harold could have said, leave me alone. You're in my way. You're bothering me. Hey, whatever. You know what Harold said? Well, that sounds really good, Eric. What's your name, Eric? Let's go to lunch. And for the last 25 years, I spent time almost every week with Harold Brantley. Learned how to be a pastor. He's warned me of the dangers. He stood beside me during hard times. Taught me how to play golf badly. I mean, just all kind of stuff. He plays good. I don't. Plays well. Who are you pouring your life into? I look now and I realize that this morning, right now, there are four different pastors who were in either my youth groups or college groups over the last 25 years who right now are teaching other people. And I got to at least be a little part in helping them to find their way home to Christ. And today they're teaching other people. Who are you teaching what you know? Now here's some benefits of apprenticing other people. You learn more about your gifts by teaching. Your gifts are multiplied. You connect to others. By the way, everybody in church needs to feel needed and known. And here's what happens. If you don't use your gifts, even if, now this is tea, but even if this was just water, if you leave water in a cup and you never pour it out, you know what happens? It gets stinky. Do you know what happens to Christians that never serve, never use their gifts, never bless other people? They get stinky. They get bitter. They get selfish. They get self-centered. They think church is a country club instead of a mission house. They begin to think church is about them and not about reaching the world. Their lighthouse becomes, their life-saving station becomes a little club. But when we begin to serve and begin to reach out, you know what happens? God's supply never ends. He continues to pour into us and the water is fresh. He changes us. And number four, you will leave a legacy after your presence. I already talked about that. And then finally, you're following the example of Christ. Now, we're just going to look at this real quick just so you know. This is how Surfside, this is some of our main purposes. Scripture and prayer. Listen, you cannot have spiritual things unless you know what the Bible says. Unless you spend time in prayer. Unless you realize there is an enemy that hates your guts and there's a God that loves you. And as you pray, you realize both those things and you deal with both those things through spiritual warfare. Also through realizing that God absolutely loves you. We unite in small groups. We reproduce through apprenticing, which we're talking about today. And then we talked about last week the four environments for growth. Now, this is probably the most important part of this message other than the scripture. Three steps to apprenticing others. So I want to go back to my son mowing the grass, okay? So first, I show him, and he watches. So I showed him how to start the mower. I showed him how to turn it off. How to start the mower and turn it off. I showed him how to go down roads. All right, and then I go, okay, go. And then I watch him, and I go, okay, it's pretty good. And then you know what I do? This is where we struggle. I walk away. Too many Christians teach somebody else, they show them how to do it, and then they stand over them. You know, it'd be like if I went around and helped my son mow the grass. You think he'd get tired of this? Absolutely. And too many Christians are afraid to let go and let somebody else do it. I can tell you there's a church that I worked at over 20 years ago that if you went this morning to church and you showed up in their parking lot and you parked in their parking lot and you walked in the front door, the same guy who handed me a bulletin would hand you a bulletin. Because he's never let anybody else do it. This is his bulletin, his spot. Discipleship is about taking what you know and giving it to somebody else. Something as simple as bulletins. One of my favorite places to get people to start serving is greeting. You know why? Because let me tell you how involved it is to greet. First, you put a mint. Please put a mint. Please don't have the pastor's coffee breath. You need a little mint. Okay. And then you teach people, don't just talk to the people at the door. Look for the people coming in, especially the visitors. And if you're pretty sure they're visiting, you say, hey, the bathrooms are on the right. The children's ministry's there if you need it. And there's coffee in the back and food. And you teach people. You show them where to go. And that's it. That's it. You've been trained. All of you are trained now. You can be greeters. All right? So you start them very simply. And Sheree and I were talking about that this week. She said, you know, it's hard because I do the greeters and I lose greeters all the time. I said, what do you mean you lose greeters? Well, they move into other areas of ministry. I said, that's awesome. That's exactly what we want. We want people not to just get stuck where they are and this is my place. We want it to change. In first service, I'll say it again. If this praise team is exactly the same year, 5 years from now, we have missed God's calling. If the same ladies are standing up here, if the same people are playing all these instruments, we've missed it. By the way, if you look at the last 5 years, this has changed. So we're doing good, but it's easy to stop because we begin going, mine, mine. Actually, that is yours, Angelique. I won't mess with it, but yeah. But I can tell you right now, Angelique's somewhere right now where somebody's pouring their life into Angelique to help her to grow. And as she goes through life, she's going to pour her life into others. And whatever you know how to do, you may think it's not very spiritual. Working on cars isn't very, fishing isn't very spiritual. Do you know how many guys I've had deep conversations with while catching fish? Hey, a lot of you are really good at eating. I've spent a lot of time sitting with people and talking about important things while eating. I'm a professional eater. So I started working out. All right. So let's look at practically. How do I apprentice someone? Don't worry, this isn't going to go forever. Whether you're baking, whether you're running sound, whether you're helping do the presentation. By the way, I think we got about 8 people now that are stepped up to help with the presentation stuff. And Judy's did it for almost 6 years by herself, and now we're passing it on to all kind of people. Whatever you know how to do, are you passing it on to someone? Everything that you do can be a ministry. It just depends how you do it and who you do it for. All right, number one, connect with and forgive the one you're teaching. What? That's like the worst thing you've ever said, Eric. Okay. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other as in Christ God forgave you. If you deal with people, you have to forgive them. You've got to forgive them, and you've got to give them grace. When I first started playing drums in church, I did as a kid, but then I played at Park Avenue. They had an awesome drummer who toured. He did tours. He let me play. He said, hey, I'll do Saturday. You do Sunday morning first service. And he let me play. And then he would let me play the drums, and then he'd come and go, hey, listen, that drum beat you're doing, that one kind of throws everybody off. Do a little different one there. Okay. Okay. But he didn't come and say, give me those drumsticks. You can't play. Get out of here. But that's what we do. We don't forgive. We think, oh, you make any mistake, I'm back. Let people make mistakes. Let them blow it. Let them mess up. And by the way, you have to forgive you too, because you'll say dumb things to the people you're with. And you'll think, I don't really want to be around me. Number two, teach what you've been taught with grace. Paul, listen to what he says. I already said this once, but I'm going to say it again. You then, my son, be strong in the grace. That's that word charis. Be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things you've heard me say in the presence of witnesses, and trust to reliable people who'll be qualified to teach others. Be strong in grace. Why did Paul have to be strong in grace? Because Paul wasn't perfect. Paul messed up. Paul blew it. He had to forgive and be forgiven, and he had to walk in God's grace, or he couldn't do what God called him to do. Do you know how many times I want to quit doing what I do? Pretty much every Monday. Not every Monday, but a lot of Mondays. And do you know what? If they're honest with you, and most pastors won't be honest with you, but most of my friends who are pastors, when I talk to them, and I talk to them on Monday, they're like, oh, I don't know if I should be doing that. Because the enemy comes and he says, you don't need to be doing this. Who do you think you are? Or that person wrote you a mean note. Number three, recognize that following Jesus can be difficult. If you serve anywhere, if you help anyone, you ready? I'm going to give you some good news. You're going to get hurt. Listen, Jesus never said, take up your latte and follow me. Oh, Jesus, it's so good. No. He said, take up your cross. So when Dave Busby, I remember years ago, used to say this, when you come up against something difficult, and you're the pastor of the church, and I get an email on Monday morning that says, I can't believe you said that yesterday. I don't know why they have a country accent in their emails, but, you know. And I go, yeah, it's dumb. Welcome to the cross. When life gets tough and things are going, listen, if you come and you start setting up chairs on Sunday morning, I promise you that one day somebody's going to go, I don't think you should put that chair there. And you're going to go, wah, 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 wah. Welcome to the cross. Join with me in suffering. Doesn't this sound like a great invitation, Paul says? He's still talking to Timothy. Join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please everyone. Oh, wait a second. Tries to please his commanding officer. Who are you trying to please? When you only have to please God, then when somebody says something to you, you go, welcome to the cross. Welcome to the cross. And by the way, our suffering in America, come on. Come on. I'm suffering for Jesus. Somebody wrote me a mean note. When I get to heaven and the guy who was sacrificed to lions, you know, his family comes to me and goes, so how did you suffer on earth? Oh, I got a mean note from a church member and I got fired from a church. He's going to be like, my family was fed to lions. I had it great. See, we have a wrong idea. Number four, continually evaluate your motives. You will get frustrated. People will let you down. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other. Forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. What's the theme of your life? I want the people close to you to be able to say, I mattered. They taught me something. They poured their life into me. I know we're over time, but I want to give you one more story. Andy Stanley talked about his dad, Charles Stanley. And he said when Charles Stanley was in Miami, that he had this man who was an alcoholic. He used to sit in the back of church. Nobody wanted to sit near him because he smelled so much of alcohol. One day that guy gave his life to Christ, walked the aisle, gave his life to Jesus. A few months later, he came to Charles Stanley. He said, hey, I'd like to start a ministry to people who are alcoholics. So they started a ministry. They gave him a little upstairs room. Andy Stanley, as a kid, would come to the church, and there'd be these little brown bags where they had their beer in the brown bags, and they would fold them up and have them lay them, and there was all these in front of the church. It almost looked like they had candles, you know. And they'd go up and have their time. And he said a few months later, all of a sudden, that man who was an alcoholic who had given his life to Christ would now come down with somebody else who had given their life to Christ. And so after a few months, all these guys kept coming. All these guys kept coming, giving their lives to Christ. And Charles Stanley came to the guy and said, what are you doing? You don't have any training or anything. How are you leading all these people to Christ? And he said, Pastor, it's really easy. He said, every Sunday I take the sermon that you give, and then I just go up and I give it to these men. And then they give their lives to Christ. He was taking what was poured into his life, just that little bit, and pouring it into the lives of others. And God was using that to make a difference. Are you doing that? Is there anybody who you're pouring your life into? Is there any gift or talent that you have that you never thought of as spiritual that you can teach somebody else how to do and make them important in your life? If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, Angelique and the praise team are going to be coming in just a moment to lead our offering. After the service, I'll be here and you can say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ today. I've never surrendered my life to Him. Maybe you're here today, and today, at some point in the sermon, you said, oh, that one was for me. Be honest with God about that. And don't just leave it here. Take it with you, and let God begin to work on you. Don't let that seed be stolen, but let God grow that seed up in your heart today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for your word and your power. I thank you that your word changes our lives. It's not because of the pastor teaching it, but it's because of your power through your Spirit. As we teach your word, that you transform lives. Father, I pray today that if anyone in here does not know you, that today would be the day they surrender to you. Father, if there's somebody watching online today, that today would be the day they surrender to you. And Lord, I pray that we would be a church that doesn't just take in what we've learned, but we begin to pour it out on other people and we see people's lives change. So if we were the last Christian on earth, we impacted other people to come to know you. Father, make this a place where people can come home to you. We invite you to continue to work in our midst. In Jesus' name, amen. Angelique is going to lead this song. She's going to lead our time of worship tonight. And I encourage you to listen to the words. And in a minute, after the offering, we'll stand and sing with her. But I encourage you, don't get in a hurry to leave. Just let God speak to your heart during this time. Thanks for being here this morning. You give what God's put on your heart today. Thank you.